The Heart of Christ Church presents Moments from the Heart.
Hello, dear saints, and welcome back again to Moments from the Heart, a ministry in the Heart of Christ here in London, Pennsylvania. I want to thank you for joining us today as we're going to be looking at a very dear subject to my heart, and that is the reality of suffering and just what it produces in our lives. Many people, like myself, we're out here and we're talking the word, and people kind of wonder, are you qualified to even speak on these things? Well, as a minister ordained, I have my degrees, but when you start talking about suffering, many people ask, how do you relate to that? And I simply want to tell you that for myself, the Lord has grown me up through suffering in so many wonderful ways. My wife and I have lost 5 children at childbirth or prior to during our pregnancies. We have one son at the age of 4. He was diagnosed with cancer. He's now 24 years old, and the 5 years that he went through chemo and therapies were truly trying on us, as well as losing our children. I myself have had 5 heart attacks, 14 pulmonary emboli, 2 DVTs. I was in an automobile accident that crushed my hip into 14 pieces and broke my leg into 3. So as far as suffering is concerned, yes, I can equate. And I can equate with the loss of suffering through my father and my father-in-law, who both died from cancer, a long and arduous death. So suffering, yes, I know him well, but I also know that God uses suffering to teach us of himself and to grow us in righteousness. How do I know that? Let's look to the Word of God, and may your life be changed to understand just what suffering does and what its purpose is in the life of those of us who are in Christ Jesus. Turning in your Bibles, if you would, I'm in the book of 1 Peter, beginning in chapter 1 and verse 3 through 9, and then we're going to go to the book of Hebrews. From the third verse of chapter 1 in Peter, in 1 Peter, it says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes, even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Blessed be the word of our Lord." In all the things that I just spoke to you a little bit earlier in my life, I do not glory in them. I glory in God, in what he brought me through and how he used those sufferings in my life to teach me about himself, to grow me up, to mature me. And that's why they come into our lives. Suffering is going to be here because of sin. And if it's going to be here, God's going to use it for our good. Romans 8 tells us that. That God works all things to good. To those who are called according to his purpose, God works all things to good. And suffering is one of those very realities. How does he use it? How does he turn this into something that can be productive? That's where we need to go to the book of Hebrews. Stepping back just a few pages, and coming forward again. Hebrews in chapter 12. From the 4th verse, we read these words. Again, Hebrews 12, from the 4th verse. "In your struggles against sin, you have not resisted to the point of shedding your blood, and you have forgotten the word of encouragement that addresses you as sons? My son, do not take light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you. Because the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as sons, for what son is not disciplined by his father? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not true sons. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of our spirits and live? Our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines for our good, that we may share in His holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. Blessed be the word of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, right now many of you are going through a lot of trials. Many of you are going through pains that I can't even imagine with what I've been through in my life. But they're here because we live in a sin-filled world and our bodies are riddled with sin. Our DNA has been changed from the perfection of Adam to what it is today. And that all happens because of sin. But God uses it to teach us and to train us. It tells us here that God disciplines us. Well, there's two definitions of discipline. The first is punishment. The first is when we were children and we did something we weren't supposed to do, and we got the right hand of encouragement on our buttocks. At least I hope you did growing up. And I pray that as parents, you're still using that reality. For any child trained up in such a manner will be a child who learns and lives and remembers. But dear saints, that is only one form of discipline. There's another form of discipline. And that is talking of military discipline, of life discipline, where we structure ourselves and we train ourselves up. And it's difficult, it's hard, and it's trying, and it's testing. And that, too, is some of the suffering that happens in our lives, whether it would be cancer, the loss of a loved one, the loss of a job, financial failures, whatever they may be. As we suffer through these things, as we walk through these things, we are being trained up from them by God. If we turn to Him and remember that these things have come to us to train us up, because they are to produce a harvest of righteousness into the future. When we forsake them and forget them, we're doomed to learn the lessons over again. So as you're going through these times of trial, as you're going through these times of suffering and struggle, rejoice in the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Why? Because God is bringing you to His righteousness, His holiness. We who are in Christ Jesus are to emulate His image. He is returning us to the former things before sin ever came in. He's returning us to the image of God, making us one with Himself, understanding and growing in maturity and long-suffering. Suffering hurts, but if in it you remember and are trained by it, then the good that will come is a good that will last unto eternity. And that is where God wants us. For in the eternal age, we shall rule and reign with Him. And we need to be trained up how to live rightly. This is our school. Learn well the lessons that God has for us, that we may truly be the image of Christ in this world and in the next. I'm Pastor Rich, and this is Moments from the Heart. May God bless your every moment.
You have been watching a Bible teaching from the Heart of Christ Church. You can find us on the web at www.theheartofchristchurch.com. If you have found benefit in listening to this message, you can send us an email from our contact page, or if you would like to donate or write to us, do so at P.O. Box 1011, Quentin, PA 17083.